Down and grab your hymnals. They're down at the bottom.
Hymnals.
See, go ahead and turn over to hymn number 138. 138.
What is a hymn?
Joshua, this song's in the book.
And there was multiplied to me.
some really big trouble. Welcome, thank you so much for being in the house of God today. Are there any first-time guests here who did not get a visitor card when you came in? Willie already mentioned we have several of our regular people missing, and that is true. I've tried to count, and I can't quite. Thank God for first-time visitors. We got about 10 in the house today, without which we look pretty empty. So you people who are here for the first time, thank you so much for being here. We know that, you know, the agony of serving a primary military church, you never know where you're going to be from one weekend to the next. But I'm glad you're here today, so thank you so much for being here. If you are a first, when you leave over in the welcome center, which is the room right outside there, we have a little memento for you to take home so you can remember your first trip to Aviano Baptist Church. I'm usually busy shaking hands, so you have to kind of nudge and say, "Give me my stuff, preacher!" And I'll get we want you to take it home with you to remember us. Tonight, one of the most exciting weeks of our year begins. Faith Eastern Bible School tonight, 4:55 p.m. is showtime. And we had a great time on Friday over at the VX trying to register children. We were quite successful. We had several registrations, and a lot of people wanted to know more information about our church. It was really good. I want to thank Dennis and Carrie Pearman for manning the table, and Bryce and Faith Ron, and then my wife, Adele, worked with me for an hour, so we got the job done, and we just really had a good time. If you have not registered your children, it's not too late. We're ready for them, so you can see Sarah, raise your hand back on the back row. She's the lady singing up here. Little tablet thing. See her? She's got the registration form. We'd love to have your children in vacation Bible. For the adults who need to bring your children and don't know what to do with yourself while your kids are here, starting at about 5:30 downstairs in a room that we've been assigned, I will be teaching a Bible class for adults. And so you're free to come. Now, we're not going to do the whole 2 hours, 2.5 like the children. We'll do about an hour, hour and a half, depending on how long you want to talk about the subject being taught. But we will have something for you to do for part of that time. Help you make it through that hour and a half, the rest of the time, or that 2 hours and a half. But we'd love to have you come. I have been laid on my heart to teach a little series on what I call the five most important prayers in the Bible. Now, there's room, of course, to dispute these things. And I got to think about that. They may not be the five most important prayers, but for you and me as human beings to pray on a regular basis, I think the ones I'm going to be teaching are the five most important prayers. I'd love to have you come and join me down there so I don't get bored. So that's something we're trying to do to make things possible. I'm going to kind of go here in chronological order to help you see some important things coming up. I have right here, finally, you see, God's Not Dead, DVD, Blu-ray, whatever you want to call it. And we have a community-wide movie night scheduled for Tuesday, August 26th. That's 1 week from this coming Tuesday night at the Base Theater, 6 o'clock movie night. Doors open at 5:30. And here's what we want you to do. If you've already seen the movie, you know what a great thing it is. Get some people you know and bring them to the Base Theater on Tuesday night, August 26th. We want people to see this movie. It's powerful. It has a tremendous message. You may know many people who have the same question that the old professor in this movie had, and they will benefit from seeing that. So we want you to take advantage of that. Bring some people, and we will actually give a gospel invitation at the end of the movie. So bring people along, please. It's no charge, by the way. If you want to make a donation or do that with the theater out, that's fine, but it's no charge. On Sunday, August 31st, the fifth Sunday of this month, we will be having a potluck fellowship. That is our custom. Every time there are five Sundays of the month, we have that fifth Sunday as a potluck fellowship downstairs. There is or will be a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board right outside this door. Is it out there yet? I don't know. I didn't look.
Yes.
It's out there. Okay. You can sign up and tell us what you want to bring. Now, here's what we ask people to do. Bring enough food, whatever you're cooking, for your family plus a couple of other people. That way we never run out. Because there are always new people show up here who didn't know, and they come hungry, and so we want to feed them as well. And by looking at the list, what other people have signed up for to bring, you know, don't bring the same thing. You don't want 14 hams and nothing else to eat, okay? So that'll be right after the worship service, right here downstairs in our church. Now, those of of you who've been around know that we're talking about finding another location. We're being actually required to find another location because our contract in this building expires in November 2015, and it will not be renewed. The landlord's already told us that. So we're looking at options all around the neighborhood. On Sunday, September 7th, when we finish the worship service here, we have the liberty of getting in our cars, driving just up the road toward Portinoni, about a mile, just up here near Scarpe is, to look at a prospective building that we could possibly, if we worked in, that we could possibly rent and could become our church building. We want you to see it because you're ultimately going to be the ones who make a decision. Where do we go? What do we rent? Where do we meet? That kind of thing. So put that kind of on your calendar. We'll go straight from here after church, drive right up there. The landlord will be there to show us the building. And we'll talk about it and see what the potential is. I have seen it from the outside. I have not yet been inside it, so it'll be a new thing for all of us. Our church family has been blessed in the last few weeks with three brand new babies. Two little boys and a little girl have been born. Our women's ministry has a custom of giving a basket to new mamas and their babies. So we're asking you ladies, think about newborns, two little boys, one little girl, buy something that's appropriate for newborn, give it to Faith Ron. Is Faith in the room? There she is right there. She's the women's ministry coordinator. Give stuff to her and she'll put it all together. We'll make three little baby baskets and give these new moms and dads the first chance we get sometime in the next week or two. One other thing, we have a ministry opening up to provide food and good used clothing to immigrants and impoverished Italians, people who are living in our community who are having a hard time making ends meet. If you don't know this, the Italian economy is just about as low as it can get without completely breaking. And there are lots of people around who are either unemployed or underemployed. There are lots of Italian pensioners who are making barely enough to buy food, much less pay rent and utilities. And we have a couple whose God has put it on their heart to provide food. We have a box out in the Welcome Center. Adele and I, each time we go to the commissary, we buy one extra item and bring it, toss it in there. And we want staple stuff like beans, rice, pasta, that kind of stuff. We don't really need all the exotic spices you have in your cabinet when you go PCS. You don't know what to do with it. Hungry people aren't too much into that. We want stuff that people can actually make a meal out of. So don't make things of that. If you have used clothing that's in good shape and clean, you can donate that. We're going to set up a distribution system. We got a couple working on that. We're going to have a distribution system to have people come in and pick this stuff up free of charge. So we need you to help us out with that. Okay, are there any announcements out there I have failed to make? Would you take just a minute then, stand up, shake one another's hand, greet each other in the name of the Lord? Let's have a great time in the house of God today.
Great blessing. We brought this summer school. We brought this summer school. Good morning. Good morning.
There's a heaven that I'd rather be than dancing with you. Worthy of all our praise.
amazing God. We just thank you for gathering us all here today, Lord, to worship you freely, Lord, in spirit and in truth, Lord. We just thank you for this time, Lord, again. We have this time to listen to Brother Pastor, Brother Jeff. Lord, just as he preaches the word this morning, and we just pray you would fill him with your spirit, Lord. Lord, we know there's a lot of people hurting, Lord, people are in need, Lord, people that are sick. Lord, just pray you would comfort them. Lord, send your spirit upon them, Lord. Tithes, these offerings, Lord, these small gifts that we give to you, Lord, that they would bring you glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you're listening, you can sing with us.
Church family, and we just ask, Lord, you lead them at the place where you want them to be during the time here at Aviano. Thank you that you brought them here today, and we pray that you'll bless them richly. Father, we do have so many people out traveling. The Starries are in the United States. Shijo Abraham's in the States. Ike and Stacy Williams, your family, traveling today. We pray you give them all safety. Just bless them as they're away. Daniel Kalaja just went away on a six-month deployment. Bless him where he is. We pray he'll find Christian brothers and sisters there to spend time with and to worship and serve with while he's deployed serving his country. Lord, especially for Stacy Williams, we ask, Lord, you take that migraine headache from her. Help get rid of whatever causes it in her life. Help her to overcome it. Just take it away from her so she never has to worry about that again. We pray for that. Lord, we ask that you be with our guys who fly the airplanes, the airway on exercises in the States, and just ask you to keep them all safe, let them fulfill their mission there, and return to their families here, and Lord, we'll just rejoice over that too when they're all back at home. Father, we come this morning with open hearts and open arms. We're hungry. We need to hear from you. More than anything else, Lord, we need your Holy Spirit to come into this room, move up and down the aisles, across the pews, into our lives, touch us, minister to us as you know the need to be. And Lord, we just rejoice that you have filled us with your presence. And when you've empowered us to do the things you put before us, we will rejoice. And Lord, we will serve you with all our hearts. Thank you again for this golden opportunity. Bless us now as we go to God's word. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. If you have your Bible, turn in it again to 1 Samuel chapter 17. Kind of be locating yourself over somewhere around verse 25 or 30. I don't know where I started at. And we'll go through a sermon here. I'm preaching a mini sermon here for those of you who are here for the first time, a mini series on the David and Goliath story. And we're looking at what it has to teach us in terms of practical everyday living. Today is the last of those sermons in that series. Earlier we had our website up here on the board. It's just simply AvianoBaptistChurch.org. You can go there if you're really interested in the first three series, sermons in this series. You can find them in the archive there and listen to them on your computer at home. But today we close this series of messages. I love what's going on in the Air Force today with the wingman program. Everybody got to have somebody who's got their back, right? That's what it's all about. Well, I think that's a good thing. It's a great principle for life. Everyone needs somebody. And my question to you today is, who's got your back in the spiritual battles of life? It's a very, very important question. John Ortberg is a Presbyterian pastor, Menlo Park Baptist Church out in Presbyterian Church out in California. He's one of my favorite Christian writers, and I forgive him for being non-Baptist, okay? He's a great writer and a great preacher, and he loves to tell a story about him and two of his Christian friends, one a fellow staff member of the church, the other a deacon in the church where he was, walking on a beach in Newport Beach, California. And as they walked down the street, a bar fight that had started inside the bar spilled out onto the street in front of them. And what it was essentially was a small group of guys pounding the daylights out of this other guy. Well, they're Christians. They try to step in and say something that will break up this fight and save this guy who's being pounded. But nothing they said was working. No one was paying any attention to them. And Pastor Ortberg says that at one particular moment, all of a sudden, everything just stopped. And the assailants looked up. Their eyes got about that big around, they started backing away. He and his two buddies wondered what on earth is happening. They turned around and looked, and there stood a guy at the door about 6'7", somewhere around 300 pounds. Pastor Ortberg says, probably 2% body fat. He was just standing there flexing himself and just hoping these guys would take him on, and they saw him, they just began to back away. He said in his story, he preached this in a sermon, by the way, about big God, little God. He said, right away, he began to be filled with a new spirit. He said he told those guys as they backed away, don't let us catch you around here again either. Something he wouldn't have dared say just a few minutes ago, but now he's got this new boldness. He's filled with courage. They privately, not where this big guy could hear, but they nicknamed him Bubba. And Pastor Ortberg tells in this story how he began to imagine if he had Bubba with him all the time, what a different human being he would be. Nobody would dare mess with him if he had Bubba to just come with him and have his back everywhere he went. And then, of course, you can see, you can already imagine the conclusion. He began to think, wait a minute. I have got a Bubba bigger than that guy. And he's got my back everywhere I go. Who's got your back? I want you to look at with me here in
1 Samuel 17. And we're going to go through here. I'm starting at verse 43 to talk about the first point. And I just simply have 2 points today, and actually three, two and a half. I want you to see that in the preparation for the battle, God has your back. Now listen, let me set the stage for you so you can understand where I'm going. For those of us who are trying to live our lives according to the instructions of the Holy Bible, according to the leadership of God the Holy Spirit, those of us who are trying to obey the Lord Jesus Christ and all the things He's told us to do, life comes in just simply two phases. You're either preparing for the battle or you're fully engaged in the battle. You'll be doing one or the other all the time. So then I might say, well, preacher, that doesn't describe me. And I'll say to you, I'm sorry it doesn't. Because the only other place where you'd be is just totally disengaged from the battle, completely off the field, out of the game. You're not part of the battle. That's not any place for Christians to want to be. You either want to be preparing for the battle or fully engaged in the battle. And as we look at the story of David, we find both those things going on in his life. And I begin reading in verse 43 of 1 Samuel 17. So the Philistine said to David, am I a dog that you come to me with sticks? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine said to David, come to me, I'll give your flesh to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. That's the battle. Somebody's going to try and kill David. But let's go back now to verse 26 and see David preparing himself for the battle. In verse 26 of chapter 17 of 1 Samuel, then David spoke to the men who stood by him, saying, what shall be done for the man who kills this Philistine and takes away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? And the people answered him in this manner, saying, so shall it be done for the man who kills him. Now Eliab, his oldest brother, heard when he spoke to the men, and Eliab's anger was aroused against David. He said, why did you come down here? And with whom have you left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know your pride and the insolence of your heart. You have come down to see the battle. And David said, what have I done now? Is there not a cause? Then he turned from him toward another and said the same thing. And these people answered him as the first ones did. Now when the words which David spoke were heard, they reported them to Saul, and he sent for him. Then David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine. And Saul said to David, you're not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him. You are a youth, and he a man of war from his youth. But David said to Saul, your servant used to keep his father's sheep, and when a lion or a bear came and took the lamb out of the flock, I went out after it and struck it and delivered the lamb from its mouth. And when it arose against me, I caught it by its beard and struck and killed it. Your servant has killed both lion and bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, seeing he has defied the armies of the living God. Moreover, David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go, and the Lord be with you. David is preparing himself for battle. You're here in church today, I hope, with the attitude you're preparing yourself for battle. The Lord says we live in a spiritual warfare. It's a war fought in heavenly places with us as we're both warriors on the field and we're the prize being fought for. It's spiritual warfare that goes on all the time. If you're trying to obey God, you're either preparing for the battle or you're fighting the battle, one or the other. Now, here we go. David, first of all, what is the challenge? What's the battle? It's this 9-foot-6-inch guy here with this spear, bigger than a weaver's beam, a spearhead, weighs 25 pounds. He's got on a coat of armor, weighs over 200 pounds. That's the challenge. That's the challenge. He's a whopper. He's a big guy. And he's defying the armies of the living God, and he's going to kill you if he gets a chance. What is the need? Well, somebody needs to go out there and deal with it. Now, the whole army of Israel sitting here on this mountaintop looking out across here, and this guy standing down in the valley, they're scared to death. Somebody needs to get on the field and take care of this guy. There is a need. Well, what am I going to go with? You know, we saw it last week. Saul tried to give him his armor. That won't work. So David took his sling and 5 smooth stones. He got the equipment. And then the final thing he did before he went into the battle was, he said, God, who has helped me win battles in the past, will help me win this battle. David said, I'm not going out there unless somebody has got my back. And I know who it is because he's had my back before. He'll have my back again. Listen, when God has got your back, when you come to you, you're well preserved, you're well protected. You need to be prepared for battle, knowing God. But I believe had he not known the living God, he would have had no courage, whatever. He would have been like all the other Israelites. Now, they knew about God. We don't know how many people were in that Israelite army. We don't know what kind of experiences they had in the past. What kind of battles have they had to fight? What kind of victories have they seen God do? We don't know about their lives. They may have been the kind who never, ever got God engaged in any important issue in life. They may have always been the kind that backed away. So when it came time to face this 9-foot-6-inch giant out there in the valley, they were terrified. They did not know what God could do because they had never proven the smaller things in life. David had put God to the test. God had come through. God had had his back. And David had always won all these battles. And he knows based on experience how to do this. Why? Because God has got my back. We Christian people are supposed to be, from God's perspective and from the viewpoint of the world, we're supposed to be the most courageous people on this planet. And you and I have some brothers and sisters in Christ today who are living out that. We have brothers and sisters in Christ around the world who are being persecuted this very day for trying to leave their home and go to the house of God. Some of them will have to pay with their life, maybe with their good. Who knows what kind of horrendous things will happen to some of them today. They have the courage, knowing God's got their back. But we Western Christians, instead of being powerful, we become somewhat what kind of pitiful. We just try to stay out of the fight. We don't want to be involved in conflict. We don't want to take any chances or any risks, even for faith. I am not a preacher who often encourages my people in church to read a non-Christian piece of literature. But there is one book I wish with all my heart every Christian would read. And it is a book called In Search of the Warrior Spirit. It's written by a guy named Richard Strozzi Heckler. He's a guy who is part of an organization that trains Special Forces troops, Marines, Navy SEALs, all those special people, to be psychologically prepared for the conflict they're going to go into, for the challenges that they're going to face as they carry out their military missions. And he's good at this. He's written this book, In Search of the Warrior Spirit. I picked it up because the title appealed to me. It's on the book closeout table at the BX. I love stuff that's on sale up here. So I picked this book up and took it on In Search of the Warrior Spirit. See, I know God is a warrior. And I know he has called you and me to be in his army participating in the conflict. You and I are supposed to be warriors in the army of God. So I want to know, what does this guy have to tell me that will help Christians? Now, my goodness, how that book enlightened me. Here's just one quote out of that book. You and I, we don't jump into the battle because we have these little personal things inside us, keeping us from wading in the way we're supposed to do. Strozzi Heckler says, the urge to confront personal ghosts and uncover our full potential is ignited only by an inner need. This arises from a discontent about who we have become. When the need becomes strong enough to challenge the status quo, we summon the commitment and courage to attempt the unknown. In order to face the demons that arise when we move past the boundaries of our small self, we need precisely the courage of our commitment to move forward. If we do not have this commitment, it's altogether too easy to say it hurts or is uncomfortable and then resort to our smaller self. He's talking about people who get hung up in a comfort zone. And anything outside that comfort zone is just too challenging, too risky, too painful, too uncomfortable. I just can't step out and do that because that's not who I am. I don't do stuff like that. And he's talking about, no, the unknown. You got to step into the unknown. I read another great book one time. If you want to walk on water, you got to get out of the boat. We don't want to get out of the boat. A lot of us Christians are never going to have a water walking experience because we're too comfortable in the boat. We're never going to step over that rail into the water. God wants us to come with courage, knowing that he has our back. This whole thing about being prepared for battle while you're here in church, I'll take you back some 30 years or more. The time I came out of my life of Protestantism began just devouring the Bible as fast as I could read it. There was a verse of scripture, especially when I knew God was calling me to preach. What kind of a man am I supposed to be? I found this verse, and I'm taking it completely out of context. I want you to understand that. It's in 1 Corinthians 14, which talks about this speaking in tongues and things that got Christianity so divided. But there's a verse there, verse 8 of chapter 14. It says, for if the trumpet makes an uncertain sound, who will prepare himself for battle. That's talking about what kind of language you speak when you're speaking to people in church. It's talking about those uncertain sounds, those tongues that people can't understand. But we don't believe that that's part of the Christian experience, and so we don't do that in our Baptist churches. But I like it. If the trumpet gives an uncertain sound, who will prepare himself for battle? In church, what are you here for? You're here to prepare yourself for battle. And so you need to hear a certain sound, nothing uncertain. You need to be given a positive message, a message that will guide you down the road and help you out. And again, in Ephesians 6:13, you probably know this passage. It's about the armor of the Christian warrior. And verse 13 says, therefore take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. The Bible talks about you and I being in the house of God to prepare ourselves for the battle that awaits us outside the house of God. And I hope you come to church with that in mind. God has your back in the preparation for the battle. Did you see how many times David said he's challenging the armies of the living God? Who's going to go take care of that uncircumcised, that man of no faith, whatever, that anti-God person standing down there in that valley? Who is going to go? And he concluded, it will be me, and I will go because God has my back. The same God who helped me kill a bear and a lion will help me kill this guy, and it's not a problem. So he's going to go and do this. He knows who has his back. He knows what the challenge is, and he is going to do it. David is not the only heroic warrior we find in the Bible who understands these kinds of things about when God's got your back, you can take on anything. I love the book of Jeremiah. He was a heroic warrior of faith. He's known in our modern language, in theology circles, as the weeping prophet, because he preached and preached and preached and nothing happened. He just wept over the losses of his country, the southern tribes of Judah, there in God's holy people. But in chapter 20, verse 7 through 9 of the book that Jeremiah wrote, he kind of gives a picture of himself as a warrior who knows who has his back. Oh Lord, you induced me. Now that word induced, he wasn't pregnant, guys. It wasn't a late delivery, nothing like that. It comes from a Hebrew word that means to make roomy, to expand, make larger. In a figurative sense, speaking in a mental or moral sense, to be or make simple, to allure, to enlarge, to entice, to persuade. You induced me, you persuaded me, you enticed me, and I was persuaded. You are stronger than I and have prevailed. I am in derision daily. Everyone mocks me. That's what most of us Christians, when we're doing anything, we don't want to be mocked or made fun of. Jeremiah didn't care, and he'll tell you why right here. Everyone mocks me. For when I spoke, I cried out. I shouted, violence and plunder. This comes at a place where God is having him tell Judah the punishment that's coming from God because of their rebellion. They followed the northern kingdom of Israel into rebellion against God, into idolatry. And all he's been preaching so far is judgment, 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 violence, violence, violence. And that's what he's talking about here. Violence and plunder. Because the word of God, of the Lord, was made to me a reproach and a derision daily. They're mocking the daylights out of me as I go around doing what you tell me. Then I said, I will not make mention of him nor speak any more in his name. I'm going to quit. He came to a place where so many modern Christians live. I wanted to quit. But then he says this. But his word was in my heart like a burning fire shut up in my bones. I was weary of holding it back, and I could not. So what'd you do, Jeremiah? I waited and I kept on preaching. It got me in all kinds of trouble, all kinds of punishment, but I just kept on doing what God knew. Why? Because God's got my back. His fire is burning in me like his word is burning in my heart like a fire, and I just couldn't shut up. Oh, my goodness. In Kentucky, where I grew up, we have a term. People, sometimes we talk about people who've got a bad case of the can't help it. They know what they ought to do or not do, but they just can't help themselves. They just give way to the impulse, and they can't help it. Well, my goodness, God wants a whole bunch of his children to get a bad case of the can't help it, just like Jeremiah had. I didn't want to say that. I didn't want to witness to that lost person. I didn't want to tell that person that just used God's name in vain. God done like, I didn't want to do anything to help straighten out the mess in our world because I know what people are going to say or do, but I just can't help it. Woo! Things would start getting good if Christians would get a bad case of the kingdom. So I'm telling you right now. He just couldn't stop. Why? Because he was a warrior, and he was involved in a conflict, and he had a great ally. He knew who that was. The power of the enemy that we face requires that we be prepared for the battle. I don't know if you can imagine how what scene was unfolding that David going out in that valley before Goliath without being prepared, without knowing God's got my back, without knowing there is a cause, this is worth doing. Whatever it costs me, I've got to take it on. It's that important. I know who's got my back. I've got my familiar weapons and stuff I know how to use. What would happen if he gone out there not prepared? We probably would never heard of David again, except maybe his obituary. But his enemy was Goliath. To me, Goliath is an Old Testament symbol of your and my greatest enemy, God's archenemy, Satan, the devil himself. That's who you and I confront on a daily basis. That's who insists, who persists in declaring war against us and waging war against us. That's why you and I cannot drop out. We're either fighting and winning, or we're surrendered and defeated. There's no middle ground in this conflict with Satan. He has awesome power over all other created beings. Now get what I said. Understand what I said. Satan has awesome power over all other created beings. In the book of Jude, verse 9, it's only one chapter, Michael, the archangel, the highest ranking angel in all of heaven's host, Michael, in contending with the devil when he disputed about the body of Moses, dared not bring against him a reviling accusation, but said, "The Lord rebuke you." Even Michael, the strongest, most powerful, highest ranking angel in God's hierarchy of created angels, could not take on Lucifer, Satan, without saying the Lord. He had to have God to have his back before he could go against Satan. Now, you and I are not more powerful than Michael. So you and I cannot take on the devil without God's help. The Bible tells us a couple things about Satan. He's the god of this age in 2 Corinthians 4:4. He's the prince of the power of the air in Ephesians 2:2. And he's a deceiving rascal. 2 Corinthians 11:14. And no wonder, for Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. 1 Peter 5:8. Be sober, be vigilant. Your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. We need to pay close attention to that thing, seeking whom he may devour, a roaring lion. I spend a good amount of my time when the devil lets me have the remote. I like to watch Discovery Channel. I like to watch animals. I like to watch, and she doesn't like to watch all the praying and killing and that stuff, but I just like to watch God's nature work. And I have seen lions take down elephants, hippopotami, giraffes. Lions don't care how big you think you are. They'll bring you down. They'll eat you. And Satan doesn't care how holy, how religious, how sanctimonious you are. He'll bring you down. He's prowling around seeking whom he may devour. You will not be able to handle him without help from God. You have to know who has your back. There are two reasons why we should obey the words of this following passage of Scripture. In James 4, 6, and 7, I don't think this is on the screen. You may want to jot it down. James 4, 6, and 7, he, meaning God, gives more grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, he will flee from you. Now, there are a lot of Christian people who know that little phrase, resist the devil, he will flee or he'll run away. They don't much know the words that come just ahead of it. God gives grace to the humble. God himself resists the proud. Any Christian who thinks they can stand against Satan on their own power is not an humble person. And God is going to resist that attitude. But when we submit ourselves unto God, when we say, you got my back, Lord, I can handle this devil. I can handle this temptation. I can handle this trial. I can handle anything he throws at me. The fiery darts of the devil can't touch me as long as you got my back. We submit ourselves in humility. Lord, win this battle for me. Then we're prepared to go into the battle. Now, two reasons why we should obey that passage. First of all, we need God on our side. We need him giving us the grace to win the next challenge that comes. And then there's this second reason. While Satan has awesome power over all other created beings, Satan has no power over the creator beings. And I take them to the book of Job, just two times in the book of Job, when the devil's trying to get permission to take on this holy man of God. Two different times, God says to him, behold, all that he has is in your power, only do not lay a hand on his person. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. The trials and the killing all his family and other stuff that happened to him didn't bring Job down, so Satan goes back to God again. And he asks for more permission. And God says to him, behold, he's in your hand, but spare his life. Satan has no power over he who created all beings, including you and me. That's why we need, when we're in this warfare, if you're preparing for the warfare, we must do so with an attitude of submission unto God. Only when he has our back are we going to come out of this victorious. Well, he has our back during the preparation. I'm going to try to close in the short time here. One more major point. God has your back in the midst of the battle. When the battle is raging all around you, you're into it up to your eyeballs, you can't see any way out, God still has your back. Here's what we read in the Bible, 1 Samuel 17, beginning of verse 45. David said to the Philistine, you come to me with a sword, with a spear, with a javelin. See, Goliath has already threatened him. We're going to feed your bones to the birds of the air. You come to me with a sword, with a spear, with a javelin. I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand. I will strike you and will take your head from you. And this day I will give the carcasses of the camp of the Philistines to the birds of the air and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. Then all this assembly shall know that the Lord has not saved with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. He is now engaged. He's down here standing face to face with this guy, looking up at him, kind of like that, I would imagine. He's in the battle. The God who had my back while I was over there getting myself psychologically and spiritually prepared, he is now down here with me on the battlefield. And he is going to give you to me. Not only you, but your entire army out there is going down because God has my back. Now, you know how the story unfolds. He had his sling, and he had five smooth stones and a little shepherd's pouch. He reached in and took one, and he wound that thing up, and he let go. Now, I'll talk to you a little bit about how I used to try to play with those things. This is a hard thing to do. I want you to understand that. You take one, and you go home and make yourself want to play with it, and find out if I'm not telling you the truth. If you aren't careful, it's going to come out and go straight up in the air. That stone is going to come out and go back behind you. It may hit right straight down on the ground. To hit the side of the barn, you got to be pretty doggone good to let that thing go at the right time. Well, here's what happened. There he stands, 9 feet 6 inches tall. We've already heard about the helmet, the coat of mail he had on his chest. That stone flew from that little sling and hit that guy right straight in the forehead. Now, this is amazing because the helmets in one of those days had protection for the forehead. Somewhere there was an uncovered spot that a little rock hit through, and it hit there and knocked that man flat on his back, that giant. It was a God thing. I don't care how much David had practiced out there in the field in the shepherd's field with his sling and his rock. That sling he let go at Goliath had to have been guided by the hand of the Lord. God had his back, and God slew the enemy. Make yourself a sling and play with it. That's all I can tell you. Just try it out. With God at his back, he defeated a gigantic human being. He overcame a gigantic challenge to all of God's people. And you and I can do the same thing. Now, here's what I want to tell you. This is one little battle in the life of David here when he's still a shepherd boy. He's not yet king. It's not the end of his battle with giants. And before I take you into these passages, I want you to see this. The Christian life is not just a battle. It is a war that will rage on until we're called out of the conflict and into our place of eternal rest. You're going to be engaged in this spiritual warfare every day that you live. You can either fight or you can surrender. But anyway, you're going to be confronted with it. The Apostle Paul, who I've said many times, you've been here a lot in the past, you've heard me say it probably, next to Jesus, I think the greatest man ever walked on this planet was the Apostle Paul, one of the most godly men. Came from being one of the worst, but he became one of the godliest. And he himself said in 2 Corinthians 12, 7 through 9, lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure. Concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. He said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly I would rather boast in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon you. What was God saying to Paul? Paul, that's a fight you're going to have to live with. But my grace is sufficient. I got your back. You can handle it. It's not going to go away. Now, I want you to see some things happening in the life of David. I'm not going to read the whole passage, it's rather lengthy. You can turn in your Bibles to 2 Samuel 21, starting at verse 16. This is decades after the Goliath experience. He's king now. He's the ruler of God's chosen people. You'll find in those verses, 2 Samuel 21, 16 through 22, there were 4 giants that David and his soldiers had to confront, and they slew them all. They killed them. I am amazed at one verse here, one of the giants that he killed was Goliath's brother. Of the others, it says simply they were the sons of the giant, which means Goliath and his brother were the sons of another giant. Somewhere back there in that background, there was a man bigger probably than all of them because he was the father of all these giants. David and his soldiers had to take them on. Even though they had killed Goliath decades ago, the giants keep coming and you got to kill them again. It's not a battle, it's a warfare, and the attacks are going to keep coming. You remember the story of Jesus being tempted in the wilderness 40 days and 40 nights by Satan? Those 3 temptations when he was probably at his physical weakest, he hadn't had anything to eat or drink for 40 days, and Satan comes, and Satan lays 3 temptations for him. Jesus defeats him with 3 quotes from the Holy Bible, and the devil leaves, but you know what the Bible says? He departed from him for a season. What does that mean? You won this battle, Jesus, but I'm coming back. I'll be back. You know, if Satan is that persistent in his attacks against Jesus Christ, one who he knows to be his superior, you think he's not going to be persistent in attacking you and I? It is a war, not just one battle. You need to be prepared. Because the enemy is going to keep on and keep on coming. Well, with God having my back, is there a chance I can fail? Well, of course there is. Of course there is. God can't fail, but you and I, even with him having our back, you and I can fail. We can make mistakes. We can do wrong things. We can do right things incorrectly. It doesn't matter. In that same book, Richard Strozzi Heckler says, being a warrior doesn't mean winning or even succeeding. It means risking and failing and risking again as long as you live. In other words, just risk, fail, get up, way back into the battle. The fact that we've attempted to do one service for God or one good thing and we failed, doesn't mean you quit. The fact that we tried to do something to help improve the sinful condition around us and we failed, doesn't mean you quit. You just get up and fight again. Why? Because it's a battle, it's a war, and it's not a battle. Now, I hope that up to this point, everything I've told you is kind of on a positive note. If you are in the conflict, if you're either preparing for battle or fighting the battle, God has your back. You can't get a wingman any better than that. But there is a misconception among modern-day Christians I have got to deal with. And this is going to ring just a little bit negatively, but I want you to know you've got to be warned, people. You came in here to be prepared for the battle. And if I give uncertain sounds, you're not going to prepare yourself. I want to take you to a very familiar passage of Scripture. Matthew 28, 19 and 20. This is what you and I are supposed to be doing. It's the summarization of everything we're supposed to be doing in our part of this conflict. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, and I bet you can quote the rest of it, I am with you always, even to the end of the world, or the end of the age. So many modern day Christians take a great deal of comfort in the fact that here is a verse of Scripture that says Jesus will be with me always to the end of the age. And they don't understand that that promise comes with a string attached. This promise applies to those who are busy doing those things said in the earlier part of the passage. Those who are out there trying to make disciples. Those who are getting them in and getting them baptized. Those who are teaching them to observe things. Those who are actually involved in the battle. Those people can count on God having their back. People who drop out of the battle, who don't go on the battle, who never get involved, cannot take comfort from that verse of scripture. I'm sorry. That's biblical truth. You can take no comfort from that. Now, okay, I'm saved. What am I not ever? Okay, you still have the Holy Spirit within you. God is still your Father. You're still saved. But you cannot count on God giving you victories and all the little aggravations you get involved in, the little temptations and problems, because you're not involved in the battle. God's on the battlefield. You got to be there with Him. If you want Him to have your back. You want Him to have your back. I was a sophomore in high school. This is ancient history. I was on a football team. It was a year that our high school team was the only one in the state of Kentucky. Went undefeated and untied. We had a perfect record. The only team in the state that year. We had big boys in the two classes ahead of me, guys who flunked two or three years and get set back. And, you know, you can't, that probably would never happen in your school, but when I was going to school, you could still fail and get set back. So they had some 18 and 19 year olds, and one guy halfway through season had to quit because he hit his 20th birthday. And they had some guys who went on to play college football, and I was 135-pound sophomore. They used us on the practice field for what they used, sandbags and blocking them. We were the things that the big boys practiced on. Well, we come up home, and I had a real good friend in my class, in church with me in my class, and he had a girlfriend in the year right behind us, and he played trombone in the band because it's homecoming. The band got to be out on the field. His girlfriend was her class's candidate for homecoming queen, and she needed an escort. He came and said, "You think, you know, that the coach would let you not dress for the game, and because you never get on the field anyway, like, would he let you kind of just skip it and escort my girlfriend?" My idea, he won't even know if I'm not there. And I really believe that. And so I didn't go to the locker room that night, put on a football uniform. I put on my little black pants and my little cummerbund and my little, you know, dress jacket, my little boutonniere, you know. I went to the party in the homecoming parade on a Friday night. On Monday, coach called me to his office. And he laid it on me. Now, this is the guy supposed to be teaching me stuff. He's supposed to have my back. He's supposed to help me out. He's supposed to understand I'm doing something good. No. I was supposed to be sitting, even if I wasn't ever going to get on a plane, because I was supposed to be on the sidelines ready in that uniform. Even I'm not going to get a chance to even get it dirty, but I'm supposed to be there. I didn't make it through the rest of that football season, or part of that football team. It really hurt because being the only team in the state that didn't win, that didn't lose a game or didn't tie anything, they would have had a perfect record. The Junior Chamber of Commerce in our little town bought all of me pretty beautiful green sweaters with all this stuff to commemorate that undefeated season. I didn't get one. I could have been right there with all the rest of the boys. I could have had that sweater. I could have looked like a hero, even though I had nothing to do with the undefeated season. But I didn't go on the field that night the way I was supposed to do. Children of God, listen to me. So many people who name Jesus as Savior, who call God their Heavenly Father, are missing out on tremendous, rich blessings because we refuse to go into the battle. We refuse to go on the field. We forget about the fact that when God's got your back, you have nothing to fear. And we let fear and uncertainty and doubts, perhaps even apathy, keep us from going into the battle. David asked his brother, "Is there not a cause?" I'll tell you, Christian friend, you look around you, you see causes everywhere you go. You're going to spend time with unsaved people. You're going to see sinners, hear their mouth. You're going to hear them talk about all the sins they had over the weekend, whatever. You're going to be surrounded. There are needs. There are causes everywhere around you. And the battle rages on. It's either fight or flight. Who's got your back? If you want God to have your back, get into the battle. Father in heaven, your word is a powerful, powerful instrument in our lives. Thank you for the Holy Bible. I thank you for the story of David, for what it has to teach us. And Lord, I pray that you help this message today go down deep in our hearts to know that we have an ally. He's undefeated. Nothing can handle him. He's God Almighty. He has our back. If we're doing the things he's commanded us to do, Lord, we have to get into the battle. We cannot flee. We're not the ones to take flight. We're the ones to take over the fight. Because we're the army of the living God. And God has our backs. Help us, Lord, to understand that with you, all things are possible. And we can be involved in seeing some impossible things happen if we'll just let you live your life through us and work through us. Help us, Lord, to submit ourselves to you so you can give us more grace, as the Bible says you will do. We want to be humble before you. We want you as our ally in every conflict of life. We pray for that in Jesus' name. Amen. I don't know if we're going to have this number of people in church. I don't know if everyone's sitting out here born again child of God or not. I know God above wants you in his family. He wants you to repent of your sins. He wants you to confess, as he has said, I'm a sinner. There's not a thing on this earth I can do about my sin. I cannot take away the least little error I've ever made. I cannot erase it from my life. Only the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ can take away my sin. And that only happens when I repent of my sins. I tell God, I've changed my way of living, Lord. I no longer live for self. I want to live for you. Then I say, Jesus, come into my life. Bring that precious blood of yours. Wash the sins away. Make me a child of the living God. Friends, if you have never done that, it's the single most important decision you'll ever make in all your life. It changes not only your life you live now, it changes all of eternity for the better. You want to do that today. You want God as your ally. You want God to have your back. You have to get on the battlefield with him. So come and join his army today by putting your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. We'd like to talk with you about church membership. There may be some Christian here who wants to make a rededication of your life. You don't even have to speak to me. Kneel here at the altar and just, Lord, I've been doing things my way. I give up. I change. I'm going to do it your way when I get up off my knees. Come pray that prayer. Anything on your heart you want to pray about, come and share that with me. I'll be happy to pray with you. We're here to do whatever it takes to make your day complete, to help you into a closer walk with the Lord Jesus Christ. Help you get that eternal life that Jesus promised. We'll be invited into our heart. You come and you sing this hymn of invitation just for you.
I'm not afraid to
yell, "Short Danny Mayo," M-A-Y-O. She is a product of some Christian friends and a Christian husband who's been praying for her for an extended period of time. Sitting right back over there last Sunday, after we'd done the invitation, we're out on the way out of the building, she made the decision to receive Christ as her Lord and Savior. I had a great time in my office talking to her on Monday. I wish you all could have her whole story. I keep a box of tissues there for people I'm counseling to wipe their eyes. I was reaching over grabbing the tissues. I think I soaked two of them. So, I got so happy listening to her story. It was so marvelous. But she's come today to let the world know she's accepted Christ as her Lord and Savior. She wants to follow him in biblical baptism, become a member of our church. Her husband is a pilot. He's away now still in Colorado or Utah. Be home somewhere around the end of this month. So we're going to delay until the husband gets home and all the other pilots. And her baptism may turn out to be something quite special. She has some friends who are cooking up a deal, and we'll be talking to them about that later on. It may not be in our box here in Florida. It may be somewhere else. But she's come today to say, "I trusted Jesus. I'm saved. I'm part of the family of God now. I want to be baptized and become part of this fellowship." I want you to welcome her to the great big Aviano Baptist Church.
Amen.
Yeah.
just started finishing.
We have never.